was in the spring, and spring became the summer. Who'd have believed you'd come along? Hands, touching hands, reaching out, touching me, touching you.
Good morning. In light of the fact that we are heading towards Ascension, which marks the start of the initiative Thy Kingdom Come, the prayer initiative that we have been talking about to you, and Steve has been thinking about the Lord's Prayer in the previous mornings this week, I thought that we might try and tackle the subject of prayer a little bit through artworks today. And I was thinking about what kind of artworks I could show you that related to the idea of prayer. Now, it's quite interesting. If you Google prayer on, let's say, the National Gallery website, if you search their collections with the title prayer, then you'll find all sorts of images of very devout saints with their hands clasped together in an attitude of reverence. Prayer seems to be something that is still, that is quiet, that is reverent amongst the artworks that you will discover there. And I have to say that that doesn't always resonate with me. Sometimes it might, but not always. I think prayer for me is something which hopefully is a little bit more active than that, but sometimes also can be quite hard. And it strikes me that had it not been hard for a very long time, Jesus' disciples would never have said to him in Matthew chapter 6, just before he gives them the Lord's Prayer, "Lord, teach us to pray." Why would you need teaching to do something that is easy? In fact, my experience of prayer probably resonates a little bit more with a poem that I'm going to read you before I show you a couple of artworks. This is a poem by Marie Howe, and it's called Prayer. Every day I want to speak with you, and every day something more important calls for my attention. The drugstore, the beauty products, the luggage I need to buy for the trip. Even now, I can hardly sit here among the falling piles of paper and clothing, the garbage trucks outside already screeching and banging. The mystics say you were as close as my own breath. Why do I flee from you? My days and nights pour through me like complaints and become a story I forgot to tell. Help me. Even as I write these words, I am planning to rise from the chair as soon as I finish this sentence. I don't know if I'm ashamed or quite willing to say that that is quite a good depiction sometimes of my attempts to pray in the midst of the daily chaos of life. I don't know how chaotic your home life looks at the moment, but mine feels very much like the home life depicted by that poem. And there are a lot of things that distract me from sitting down and praying for a good long period of time. And I was interested when I got to thinking about this further, that actually I think people have always been easily distracted from praying. It is hard. It's hard to concentrate. It's hard to concentrate on our daily work, let alone on praying sometimes. It shouldn't be, but it is. And I was drawn to an object from the collections of the British Museum, which comes from the 16th century. Now, this is a little portable tabernacle. Now, you may remember that the tabernacle was the tent that the Israelites carried around with them in the desert that stood for the presence of God. So a portable tabernacle is a little object that can be taken with you to maybe carry the presence of God with you. Now, in this instance, it really is incredibly small. It is 6.5 centimetres high in that central body section and only 6.10 centimetres in diameter at that point. And the whole thing is only 22 centimetres tall. So it's really small, and actually it functions a little bit like a toy. And that I find very interesting. People have always played, and playing is quite absorbing. When I look at my daughter playing, she's very readily absorbed by a game that she's got herself into. She's absorbed by playing, by toys. If I want her to come and do something else, she might be very easily distracted, but she's got a great attention span for playing. And I think the artist who created this in the 16th century in the Netherlands would have understood that actually fiddling with something, playing with something, getting to grips with something by investigating it was actually a very good way of helping people to focus. Now, it was a very expensive object. It's made from boxwood and it's incredibly intricately carved. So this is not something that everybody could have owned. It probably belonged to a royal household. And it would have been therefore for use at home when they wouldn't have been out at a public church service. So maybe this resonates a little bit with our situation as well. It's an object for use when you're not in a church building. When you're travelling, when you want to go somewhere, when you are at home without a church around you. And maybe for that reason, it looks on the outside quite architectural, doesn't it? It looks very much like a Gothic cathedral in many ways, with those arches and the little tiny, tiny intricate spires. The whole thing looks like a building in miniature. Now, like any other building, it invites you to come into it. You can take the top off, and as you take the top off, the top part will open out for you in four segments, a little bit like an orange peeling back. And in those four segments are four scenes from the early life of Jesus. The Annunciation, when Mary's told she's going to have Jesus, the Nativity, Christ's presentation at the temple, and the visit of the Magi. And then in the middle, and you can turn this up and make her rise up on a little ratchet, sits the Virgin Mary. If you come down a bit to the second section, this opens up in the form of sort of two doors, and the top section has a very high relief carved image of the crucifixion, which you get to by opening two other little doors on the inside. So the whole thing is very, very interactive. And as you work your way through it, you work your way through scenes from the life of Christ, and there are more of them on the outside as well. Around the outside edge are scenes from the Passion of Christ, scenes from Holy Week. So it's a little bit like having a tiny way of the cross integrated into this object. You can walk around it with your fingers, you can think through it in your mind, you can play with it. And as you do so, perhaps you are encouraged and enabled to sit and focus for a little bit longer on interacting with God. So in this object, this very late medieval Gothic object, we're invited to play. And the interactivity of that strikes me as being something that's very important to the character of God. When we pray Our Father, we're coming to Him as His children. And I don't think He actually expects us to sit there completely silent or just saying long words to Him. I think He hopes that we will interact with Him and discover some of the mysteries of Him as He presents them to us in a way that we can handle and that we can hold. I wonder what objects you have in your houses at home that you might use to help you engage with God in new, more playful ways. This might be your prayer style. On the other hand, I was thinking about other ways in which artists have depicted for us this sort of business of trying to get to grips with how you understand somebody who is so far above us, so mysterious in many ways, and so difficult to grasp. And I think for a lot of people, prayer is quite an emotive, absorbing thing. And I was also thinking about my experience of walking around Tate Modern. If you go into one of the floors there called In the Studio, then you'll wander through some fairly traditionally hung galleries of artworks, modern 20th century artworks. And then you'll come to the central hub and you'll go in and there'll be this hushed silence. And you'll find some very sort of dim grey walls. And this actually seems very much like a large scale chapel. So we've gone from something tiny to some really huge artworks hung in a large space in Tate Modern. Now, the canvases that hang in that dim room and that seem to provoke such an air of reverence and silence and thought are known as the Seagram murals, and they are a selection of 8 or 9 canvases, there's one hangs at the entrance as well, 8 canvases on the inside, which are taken from a cycle that Mark Rothko did in 1958 to 59. He produced over 20 in total, but there are 8 of them hanging in this room. Now, they were originally intended to go in a restaurant in New York, in the Four Seasons restaurant, which was to be a new space in the Seagram building, hence their name. But in the end, Rothko withdrew from that commission, or the commission sort of withdrew him from it, because as he developed the project, he realised that he had rather a lot of scorn for the rich elite who were going to sit and dine amongst his canvases. And he famously said that he wanted to make them feel slightly sick, and this didn't seem to sit well with either the canvases or the restaurant. So he decided to withdraw from that commission, and they've now been hung permanently in Tate Modern's collection. So they're artworks that seem to provoke people to sit and look for a long time at them. And people walk around very slowly, very quietly, moving between them. Now, I don't know what you see. It's quite hard to see a Rothko on a screen, actually. You kind of need to see it in the flesh. So do go and look at them once you're able to again. Abstract art can be quite helpful for us in many ways in helping us to empty our mind of those thoughts that distract us. Things like, oh, I need to put the rubbish out, or, oh, I mustn't forget that thing that I need to pack, or whatever else it is that's filling our minds and distracting us and encouraging us to stand up every moment we sit down to try and pray. If we can be absorbed in a canvas like one of these, where actually the paint layers are incredibly deep, Rothko worked into his canvases a lot. He tried out all sorts of different paint effects. You'll find that there are depths to those canvases that you just can't see on screen. Some of them slightly shinier than others that seem to stand proud, other colours that you think are in the background and then spring out at you, or that seem to be floating on the surface and you realise were actually painted earlier. Rothko never tied them down to being religious in any way. He was a Jew by birth, but not a particularly practicing Jew. But he didn't mind if people did see them spiritually, but he didn't tie them down to a particular religion or denomination. Now, Rothko did understand art to be something that was emotive, that was absorbing, that was expressive. And indeed, he did end up making a chapel, actually a non-denominational chapel, in Houston. Now, there's a visit for you once the lockdown is over. You can go and visit the Rothko Chapel. And that is explicitly a space intended for meditation and prayer by any other name, depending on what that looks like for the denomination of the person who has gone in to contemplate those canvases. One common theme throughout the Seagram murals is this sort of frame or doorway type effect. Now, that could relate to the idea that they're paintings and they're thinking about being a frame within a frame, although they're not framed canvases. Or it could be more that they are a way of engaging you and drawing you in to the resonance of those colours. And I think that's often how people react to them and respond to them. As you sit, you're drawn in to looking more and more closely at those layers of paint. And that seems to be akin to a spiritual experience. Maybe it's even akin to gradually opening up the little parts of that tabernacle and seeing deeper and deeper inside. And maybe that's what we want to achieve in our prayer lives a little bit. The time to spend with God, not necessarily saying anything, but being willing to look for those moments where we can get a little bit closer to the depths of God's personality, to plumb the depths of that heavenly mystery, of the way in which, during the time that we spend praying, heaven sort of touches earth and we are able to reach God, or he reaches down to us. So prayer is something that is interactive. It's something that definitely can be emotive. It's something that can be uncertain. It's something that can be difficult. The psalmist tells us that. Some of those words that we're so used to reading at Easter, because they resonate with us, with the words that Jesus said on the cross, were written way before Jesus by the psalmist. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry out by day, but you don't answer. How often have we sometimes longed to say to God, what are you doing? Why aren't you answering me? And maybe sometimes we find that he's saying back, sit. Don't keep waiting to get up. Stop being distracted. Find a way of sitting with me for a bit, and maybe you'll have more of a chance of hearing what I'm saying into those moments of uncertainty and distraction that you're experiencing. So, Lord, teach us to pray. Help me. Even now, as I record this video, I'm planning to rise and go about my business and not sit and engage with you. Please help us, Lord, in the times when we are about to get up and be distracted. Help us instead to find moments where we can engage for long enough with you to experience some of your mystery in our lives. Amen.